Exposure to a high-energy cosmic storm could advance our knowledge about planetary life.
To our future.
I don't trust him.
We got what we wanted.
Just worried about what he wants.
Physical structure is changing.
It's terrible news.
I think I'll get a second opinion.
Welcome to Marvel Cinematic University. I am your professor, Mario Rivera, and joining me is the marvelous doctoral student, Sly Cone MC, who has their bachelor's in the MCU, a master's in the multiverse, and is going for their dissertation in Marvel Studies. Sly, how are you doing this week?
I am very excited to be here with you today, talking about the one and only, I guess there's many Fantastic Four movies, but the only one from 2005.
Yes.
We have not had a chance to talk about our thoughts or feelings about this movie together at all. So I'm very excited to see how you feel about this film.
Yeah, I'm very curious. You know, I was catching a vibe, but we'll see what that vibe means in a second. So we'll go from there specifically. But yeah, that's awesome. Okay. Well, we'll go on right through the show. Of course, starting with history class, where we're going to go ahead and talk about some of the little facts about the movie. Of course, this movie is directed by Tim Story, who also ends up doing the sequel. So he ends up following through with that. I believe this movie is written by Mark Frost, Michael France, who I believe has done something previously in the Marvel Universe. But also, characters are by Stan Lee and Steve Ditko, if I'm not mistaken. Studio still is Fox Studios. So from Elektra onto this one, we are still with Fox Studios. They did own a lot of pieces of the Marvel pie pretty early on and then slowly had to give their pie back because it was expiring over time. This movie, of course, stars, and I'm going to have a hard time saying this specific name because I've never been able to say it. I'm assuming it's Eloan Griffith, Mr. Fantastic.
Don't ask me.
Fair enough. This is what I think if I like slap the keyboard, that's what that name would be. But only because that's not an L, that's an I. Eloan Griffith. Sorry if I totally screwed up your name. You're pretty awesome in this movie. I'm going to give you that. Michael Chiklis, Chris Evans, Jessica Alba, Julia McMahon. This one blew my mind. Hamish Linklater, Kerry Washington, and Laurie Holden. This has a stacked cast of interesting people in different roles. And I'm very curious how they do. So we'll talk about that in just a second. Of course, where can you stream this? You can stream this over there at the old Disney Plus. Thank God they have a legacy section now, so that way if you wanted to watch all the X-Men movies or if you want to watch Fantastic Four, they don't have Daredevil there, however. I guess it's too mature for their rating system. Maybe that'll change going forward. Who knows? But Daredevil and Elektra, still not there, but who knows? Okay, here's the best part. Now, Sly, please tell me the plot of this movie.
Oh boy, is it a plot. So, pulling from IMDb, I'm assuming.
Yes, it is.
Film_fan, right?
Yes.
Four astronauts have their lives changed forever. Hold on, they're not all astronauts. Anyways, moving forward.
Whoa. Wait a minute. Well, I guess this is not wrong, I guess. They're not astronauts. They technically go to space.
They go to space, but they weren't trained.
Does that make you an
astronaut? That's a good question, actually. Okay, you know what? Fine. They go to space. I retract my argument. Four astronauts have their lives changed forever when they end up being hit by a cloud of cosmic radiation. Reed Richards now has the ability to stretch his body like elastic. Sue Storm, Alva, is now the Invisible Woman. Johnny Storm becomes the Human Torch, and Ben Grimm becomes the Thing, a man made out of rock. But there is one problem. The Journey's sponsor, Victor Von Doom, has also been affected and with full power is a dangerous force who needs to be stopped before it's too late. I'm gonna be real honest. Okay. I watched this whole movie not really paying attention to the like company name on all their like shirts or whatever. Mm-hmm. And when he said, "Call me Doom," I went, "Oh, you're Dr. Doom." I got it. But it took me way too long to get there.
That's awesome. That is hilarious. So Dr. Doom is, of course, in this movie, including Fantastic Four. These are the comic book characters created by Stan Lee and I believe Steve Ditko. Good reading of the plot. I think the plot was very on point. That's literally all the movie is. That's really it, to be honest. There's not a whole lot happening.
There's not a lot of plot to this movie.
No.
Is all
I'll say. No, they have like three sets and they're good. They're good to go. So from there, we'll go ahead and I guess go right on into it. We're going to go into our Stan Lee seminar and we're going to go ahead and talk about how we felt about the film. Sly, tell me. I'm curious. Do you want me to go first?
You were hyping up the cast of this film.
Yes.
Which reasonably so. And you were like, don't look it up. Until after you watch it. So my first three notes are the executioner from Gotham, Jonah from Runaways, and then Jessica Alba and Chris Evans as siblings.
That is right. That means Chris Evans is an honorary Hispanic. Hey, how's it going?
I was like, that's a choice.
Yeah.
You know what? Valid. But yeah, no, it just cracked me up that those were my first impressions. Where is that the executioner?
That is awesome. Yes, this is your star-studded cast of all the Fantastic Four characters, and of course your Dr. Doom. I know Dr. Doom specifically because I'm a fan of Charmed. And Charmed, much like those 90s sort of like supernatural shows, there's always the one bad boyfriend that is turns good at one point but is bad for you. Yeah, he was that version, and he was awesome. So when I saw him in this movie, I was like, yay! And then I remember at the time, I was just like not totally into the way they do Doom. I've changed on that. I'm totally into this Doom. I'm totally down. But we'll go from there. So, okay, so that is that is the star-studded main cast, but then there were side characters that I was like, what the are you in this movie? I'll mention Laurie Holden, who, if you know that name and you watch The Walking Dead, you'll know a character named Andrea. Then, yeah, she was a big character on that show for a while. Kerry Washington is huge now. Obviously, did an amazing stunt on Scandal. The character that blew me away, like, holy shit, you're in this movie, is Hamish Linklater. Now, if you don't know that name, but if you watch a little show called Midnight Mass, Midnight Mass is his, like, standout role. He is the priest in that show. He is phenomenal. So for him to have this small part of just sort of like assistant character, I was like, what the fuck are you doing in this movie? Like, I could not, you deserve so much more. And he's so young. And I'm like, all those years that we could have had. But anyways, what is the rest of your thoughts on this movie?
Overall, just like in general, I had fun with it, but it again, there wasn't a lot of content here.
No, like,
it was isn't. Just I'm excited to see where these characters go, but I didn't necessarily fall in love with any of these characters, and it was enjoyable, but it feels really forgettable.
Sure.
Like, I don't think there's a lot of moments that in a month or two, I'm going to be like, oh, remember when that happened in Fantastic Four? It was just kind of, I don't know. It was there. It happened.
That is fair.
I experienced it, and that's about it.
That is a fair assessment of this movie. And I think when I first saw this movie, I had the actual same thoughts I know that there were certain things of this movie where I'm like, oh, that's cheesy, blah, 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 blah. And is this movie changed from that? No, it's still fucking cheesy. I will say it's taken me back to a place in time to watch this movie, because if you remember, and now you probably don't, Chris Evans was the like Ryan Reynolds before Ryan Reynolds. And this is him Ryan Reynolds-ing it up. And this is me like losing my shit because, yeah, I know him as like, this was Chris Evans before he became Captain America. The moment he became Captain America, I'm like, no, he's Captain America. Like, that's it. But it's so crazy.
One of my first notes is I love asshole Chris Evans.
Yes.
It just, you know, it's so different than like when you first think of Chris Evans, you think of, you know, the very put together Captain America, but all of his other works, he's a little unhinged. And I love that about him.
He's very, almost all of his movies, even when I first saw him, which was Not Another Teen Movie, he's still fucking crazy in that movie. He does bizarre shit. No, Chris Evans is a wildfire. Like, I love him. And literally, he is, to me, the perfect version of this character. I absolutely love his Johnny Storm. I'm curious that when we eventually get to the Josh Trank other film with Michael B. Jordan as that character, and how different they are and how similar. Yes, I did just spoil that. Michael B. Jordan is Johnny Storm. But I'm just curious how different they're going to be, because I adore this. The moment, and my favorite moment of the movie, is when Johnny pulls off the outfit that is like the biker outfit and reveals the costume and the music kicks in. I'm like, this is fucking cool. I love him. I love what's happening here. It's so 2000s, like X Games bullshit. Sobe is like everywhere. I'm going to say it. I had fucking fun with this movie. It was so much of a like throwback of like, the movie didn't have to be taken too seriously and things were jokey and I'd like their interaction with each other. I fell in love with Jessica Alba in this movie because I actually thought she was cool. I remember being like, oh, Jessica Alba, she can't act like as a kid. Fuck, I'm an idiot. She's having so much fun. Her parts are funny. I mean, her parts are a little like dated. Let's be totally fair. There's like a major scene that's stupid that does not need to happen, but happens because of comedy at that time. But at the same time, like, I still like her character. I like what she does. I love her powers. I love the thing. I think it looks cool, even though it's definitely a little weird. I'm gloating about this movie. However, as I'm talking about remembering things of the past, there's some bad things about the past that we need to also make account. I'm going to say a word, and obviously I'm trigger warning it. There's a word that was said, and I had to double check myself because I was like, wait a minute. What context is he using this in? And I'm going to have to use the benefit of doubt that he's not using it for what I think he's using it for. He calls someone a fruitcake at one point. And I'm like,
it was the guy who was on the bridge who was going to jump, and he calls him a fruitcake. And I mentioned this in a previous episode. I don't remember if it was last episode or a couple episodes ago. Mm-hmm. I'm reclaiming fruitcake.
Good.
I know it's That's a awesome. Slur. I love it. Uh-huh. We're taking it back. It cracks me up.
But he said it and I was like, So I looked it up, right? The first thing you find, yes, it's a slur against homosexuals, right? However, if you look a little deeper, like to where it's originally from, it's about eccentric to, you know, potentially deranged people, which again, still not the greatest use of term, but it wasn't originally offensive towards that. People just added on because I guess fruitcake is gay, whatever.
If we can reclaim fruity as the description for being queer, we can reclaim fruitcake.
That's fine.
Like, I get it was intended as a slur at the time, but we're reclaiming that.
No, absolutely. That's totally fine. My only thing was like, what is the context of, I'm like, oh, centric or, okay. All right. Ben Graham is not a bad person. Just making sure. I had to do a check. He does say something else later, but I don't remember. That's why there was like two things he said specifically. I'm like, the words you use are can be meant for other things. But anyways, that was obviously the first thing I had to like had a gut check of like, oh, wait a minute. But once I got past, not what past it, but once I was sort of like researched, I was like, okay, okay, cool. The other thing, and I think you probably are going to bring this up, and it's specifically with Kerry Washington's character.
Yeah.
Yeah, I figured it was going to come up. I just forgot to mention it. Yeah, yeah.
Is it so hard to hire blind actors? There's so many talented blind actors out there, and every time we do these movies and there's a blind character, mm-hmm. they're always played by sighted actors.
Yeah. You're two for two, Fox, by the way, just so you know that. Three. No, he's three for three. It's Daredevil, uh-huh. it's Elektra, Stick, and then yeah, Kerry Washington.
Yeah. And I just, I know now we're at a time where our standards are higher and yes. we demand more accountability. But if we look at as recent as like, what, 2015 with Daredevil, mm-hmm. you know, obviously Charlie Cox is a sighted actor.
Yeah.
It, like, these things haven't changed in the past 20 years. And so it's just frustrating that every week I'm like, oh, here's another movie with a sighted actor playing a blind character.
Yeah.
But.
Yes.
So other than that.
Yeah. And then the fact also played by Kerry Washington, which like was like, oh shit, okay. I will say, though, I do really love that character. And I do love mm-hmm. what that character represented. I actually, my favorite interaction is in the drama class, so we'll read that phrase specifically. Because yeah, again, to reiterate, I really love the tone of this movie. Again, there's not a whole lot that's going on. It's really them just discovering themselves. There's one major scene where they do good, and it's their fault, but they do good. And then the
ending.
Can
we talk about the bridge scene?
Yeah, let's talk.
Because I have my other major problem with this movie. Is specifically on the bridge mm-hmm. when the ladder truck goes over.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
you have one person who was like in the control mm-hmm. For the ladder truck. The truck goes over, and then a bunch of firefighters mm-hmm. go onto the ladder truck without securing the vehicle. And that just took me out of it. I was like, I can't suspend my disbelief that you're going to have trained FDNY, you know, firefighters running onto a ladder truck on a bridge that's half hanging off that's not secured.
There's a lot of that come from watching 911 Lone Star and all those shows. Like,
just just general life. Why would you jump onto a vehicle that is hanging off a bridge that's not secured in any fashion?
Sure, fair enough. That's so that way Mr. Stretch can go down and grab somebody. That's literally all it's there for.
The one dude could have fallen as it was. True. Like, you didn't need other people to make that scene still happen. I don't know. That was just one moment that I was like, you lost me here.
Fair enough. That's really funny. Yes, but other than that, yeah, the scene. So the scene that I was pointing out earlier that I was like, this did not need to happen, which was like, and I don't even know how they resolve it other than they get by the crowd. So immediately Reed is like, take off your clothes. She takes her clothes off. And then, of course, her powers are not working. And so they have the like gawking scene. They have Reed, I think, at mm-hmm. one point saying, oh, you've been working out. That was weird.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I don't know if it was that scene or somewhere else. But
it was that scene.
Yeah. But the idea that she has to be completely butt-ass naked. But then what was the point of that again? I don't remember why.
They were trying to sneak past the cops that were keeping the barricade. But then all of them stuck through anyways. So there was literally no point in that happening.
By the way, reconstruct. Couldn't he just move them up above? Doesn't matter. You think too logically, it falls apart. So that part also, I'm just like, this is a dumbass joke for no reason. And I mean, it comes back later of like paparazzi. And she's like, God damn it, not again. Mm-hmm. Like, I just wish it went a little differently.
The second time I was fine with it because she had the suit on.
It makes sense.
So she just took her over layer off or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And like that was fine. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think those were all my my major issues. Sure. I do, one of my favorite moments in this film is at the very beginning. It's a conversation between Ben and Reed, and they're talking about the relationship between Victor and Sue or whatever.
Yes.
And Ben makes a comment about, like, something along the lines of, why don't you date Victor then?
Yes.
And now I ship Victor and Reed. That's my new favorite pair.
They were like this close to fucking each other. Let's be honest, because there's so many. I mean, he went to the trouble of kidnapping him, putting him in this sort of like freeze thing. But even so, he just constantly is like, "I'm better than you. I just want to be you. I want to steal all those things." You know,
would have been such a more compelling, like, romance story than what they actually had in the film. Because I did not care for any of the romance plots in this movie.
No, it's true. And
especially the end. I'm like, you've been broken up for how long and you're proposing?
Yes.
What?
For me,
not a fan of that. If it was Victor and Reed, I'd be all here for it.
I think for me, it's primarily because, you know, I'm preconditioned because of the comic book. So I'm just like, Sue Storm and, you know, them have to be together. But that at the same time, I totally agree with you. Like, this movie was like, Reed and Victor have been eye fucking each other the entire movie. They should just get on with it, to be totally honest. The whole fucking movie. It's not even a joke. It's literally like Victor wants to take everything that Reed has and just Victor, you know, and then Reed doesn't have time for Victor. That's how I feel how it goes. 100%. I think Victor is definitely a top. Mr. Fantastic is bottom. But then it could be top and bottom and wrapped around. It doesn't matter at this point.
You would think that Victor tries to exude top energy, but he's trying too hard. He would be a sub. He's a bottom.
Oh my, I love this. This is the best show we ever do.
How did we get here?
Let's be honest, this is the queerest podcast we do. This is great. sorry. These are things that make me love the movie even more. Just the interactions with the characters, just them hanging out literally the whole movie for the most part. The best joke of the movie is a visual gag when Johnny is fucking with the thing and thing is passed out and he tickles his nose and he has the best reaction, the best moment. It's just so fucking so
funny.
That's
funny, because I would say the best joke in the movie is when they're walking into the hotel or whatever. Aww. And all the kids are staring at the thing and he goes, don't do drugs.
That's a good joke.
That was my favorite.
That was good. I thought you were gonna mention the fact that he had to take the stairs. I was like,
I feel bad for him for that. No, I liked the panicked. How do I be a good role model?
Don't do drugs. It's awesome. No, it's awesome watching it. Honestly, and now, because I watched it then, but I now know so much about the world. So, like, for instance, when they talk the fact that Ben Grimm was hit Johnny Storm's CEO at one point, like, he was his above, and now they're reverse roles. So that, like, added a whole layer of why they have that dynamic. You know, you're just watching as a kid, you're just watching two people argue with each other. But then you know about roles and settings and stuff like that. It's like, oh, that actually makes an interesting dynamic of why they're constantly bowing back and forth. So I really like that. The fact that everybody has a history I thought was fun, even though we didn't have to, like, the whole movie didn't have to be us experiencing the history, which sadly is... sadly what the other movie is about. So when we get there, we'll get there. But yeah, I don't know. This was like a combination of, and stick with me, audience. This was like a combination of Batman and Robin meets Spider-Man. And I'm for it.
I'll take it.
I'm here for it.
I can see how you got there.
Yeah.
I feel like I came off very negative about this film.
It's just an okay film. I can understand that. Like,
I enjoyed it. I thought the action was fun. Like the scene with the pool crashing, yes. Like that was great. There was a lot of like fun visual elements. Yeah. Obviously the CG was, you know, fine. It was 2005.
The beginning Whatever. Is rough. The beginning is rough.
Yeah.
Yeah. But other than that.
And I liked like the like C plots, like the B and C plots. I just feel like the A plot just had no Nothing. Meat, no juice there. But like the whole like the thing plot, like his storyline with like, you know, acceptance and like body positivity, like that was pretty great. I enjoyed that. There was lots of fun like moments. All the montages were great.
Yes.
The mirror shot of Victor where he's looking at the mirror and the lights go out and the lightning's flickering and that was breathtaking. But other than that, I just it was the film.
No, that's fair. That's totally fair. I think for me, it just hits on obviously nostalgicness, but also it hits on the fact that, you know, I could care less if this movie is like the world's greatest thing. I just felt like, can I just enjoy it on the basis? And it hits all those things, right? I think that this movie holds, like, if I had to, like, okay, I say, and I wanted to talk to you about this. I think once we clear out of the 2020s and we move into the 2010s in terms of years, in terms of movies.
Oh, the
2000s to the 2010s.
Yeah.
We should do a rank system of like where we put them.
Ooh.
And then once we get past the last half, then we can rank those into it too. Because I think that in my current hierarchy, it's to me, the Hulk is still like the greatest thing that we've seen. Next to Spider-Man Probably. 2. This is like right there in my opinion. Only because of how much fun I had. The bottom, the Punisher. We're going to keep That's saying fair. That. That is an ongoing joke. At the bottom is Punisher.
Absolute dead last.
Dead
every
last.
Time.
Dead fucking last. there's no other rank. It's just dead last. Why is this a, he only watched 10 movies. Why is this one out of 20? Because we had to put that dead last. Did I knock something out? Okay. so yeah, I had fun, and I think that this is something it's worth watching. I want a similar energy for this movie for the remake again that we're gonna get for the MCU. I want it this colorful. However, obviously, do the MCU whatever you need to do. My only notes, and I wrote this on Twitter. My only notes to the director is. Can we not have any more fat jokes towards the thing? Because there's a few of them, Please. Like him breaking things in his hands is fine, but when he's like breaking chairs, and I'm like, I felt that. The waiter, the elevator scene. Even though I understood it, just the elevator scene was like, okay. So please, just not that. Just take these costumes. I love these costumes so much. I just love how. Cool they look, in my opinion. They look
I'm cheesy. Not usually a fan of a bodysuit.
Yeah.
But the way they did the bodysuits here, like, they're all skin tight and they're all, you know. So the fact that it's not just the woman in a skin tight, low cut, whatever. I would appreciate if her neckline was a little higher. Just a little bit. Yeah. But, you know, that's whatever, I'll take it because I mean the thing just had pants, which is fine, but the other two guys were also very revealed.
Yes, of course. So, very
it feels a little better to me.
That's fair. That's totally fair. So yeah, totally into that. Oh, and the one thing, I thought the stretching was fine. I know that, I mean, to me, the stretching is always going to look weird on screen, which is interesting because at the time of this recording, Miss Marvel has come out and there's clearly some changing of her character. I don't know. I think
the trailer has come out.
The trailer, yes, not the show. I think they really could have done it, but I'm curious why they decided, other than maybe because Fantastic Four is coming out, they don't want two stretchy characters, but I digress.
If you want to hear our rant about them changing the Pakistani-American girl for the sake of a white man, go listen to... Oh, gosh. What week is this?
What?
It is the Stark Radio episode from the 19th of March.
There you go.
We talked about that. Anyways.
Fair enough. Any other final thoughts before we move on to the rest of the show?
Oh, poor Jimmy, the like doorman, has to put up with so much. He was my favorite. I loved him. Shout out to Jimmy.
I'm so happy. By the way, this movie is also oddly gory, and we'll get there in a second. But you're right. I felt something when he got pushed through the door, and I was like, "No, I am." He's like the nicest dude in the movie so far. And then of course the movie's randomly gory in two spots where someone's like bleeding from their Sue does her powers. She bleeds from the nose, which is fine, but I mean gory as in Victor Von Doom straight up
shoots a hole through a dude.
Shoots a hole through not only did he shoot a hole through
and chokes the dude out.
Chokes the dude out and breaks his neck. You can see him clearly dead.
Yeah.
But you can see bone in the guy who has a hole. You see a skeleton, and it's weird. And I don't know how I feel about that. Oh, we didn't really talk about Dr. Doom. Let's talk about... Go ahead.
One of my notes was, when he choked the dude out, it was just, he straight up killed a man.
Straight up decided, you know what? I'm going to end this man's life.
All right.
It's like, okay, I guess you can do that. I don't know. You're rich. You could have had someone kidnap him. I don't know. Whatever. That happens. I don't know how he disposes bodies here. He just... puts holes in them and weird. So what are your thoughts overall with like his character, his powers, his design, any thoughts on that?
Powers were great. I loved the scar slowly growing throughout the whole film. I loved him. I fucking read the whole time. Like their sexual tension was Jeff's kiss. But yeah, no, I really enjoyed him. I thought he was great. You know, like, I think I was a little too sympathetic towards him the whole time, but that's fine.
Yeah, like I think he plays that character, really plays really good, devilishly bad guys that you somehow still can kind of root for them in weird ways. And yeah, like a part of me was like, yeah, I want you to do well in your company. I don't want you murdering anybody, especially the people I like.
He almost fits the checklist. Wait, yeah. Is he foreign?
No,
because they were talking about him going back to some random country.
So his character is So the character is from Latveria, which is a fictional place in basically. Okay, remember the twins from Age of Ultron, Wanda and Quicksilver. Pietro? Yeah, I don't know why I'm fucking losing it right now. Walter and Pietro.
Are they from Sokovia?
That is a made-up place that they made up for, but that should have been Latveria. Like, that's their version of it.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? It's like European country. Like, it's like that. Okay. Yeah. It's like that kind of
same vibe.
Yeah, but Sokovia is like totally made up for the MCU, I believe. But it would have been like Latveria, basically, where it's like European country, different name. But yeah, that's...
If you know the reference, he fits the checklist.
Yeah. PM. Gotcha. All right. I'm going to have to tell me that after the show. I will. Okay. Okay. Well, then I think that pretty much concludes our Stanley seminar. Let's move on to drama class. I have pulled a few quotes here, and these are just some of the biggest things in the movie. And then we'll go on for that. And the best, my favorite one is the bottom one, but we're going to go for the top here. Do you want to be Johnny Storm or Reed Richards?
Can I be Johnny?
Yeah. Okay. All right. I'm trying to figure out why each of us end up with different systems.
Oh, well, that's easy. I'm hot. You're a little limp. Sue is easy to see through. And Ben's always been a hard ass.
Yeah.
He's such a jerk. I love it.
I love the idea of, like, you're a little limp. Sue's easy to see through, which I find really funny. And Ben's been a hard ass. That's funny. That's easy. I'm hot. Okay. Yeah, all right.
Do you want Johnny for the next one?
Yeah, you want to be Susan and Reed? Go for it.
I'll do it, yeah.
Yeah.
You were at 4,000 degrees Kelvin. You were approaching a supernova.
Sweet!
No, not sweet. That's the heat of the sun. You could kill yourself, other people, and burn up the atmosphere, ending human life as we know it.
Got it. Supernova, bad.
Yes. Supernova, bad.
Yeah, supernova, bad. It's like, I thought that was a bad... And then later, they're like, I thought it was a bad thing. It's like, Johnny, do it! So good. All right. This, obviously, this is a little fun part here. Oh, this is two different ones. I'm going to spin this, space that out. Do you want to be Victor Von Doom or Ben Grimm?
Oh, I'm Victor.
All right, there you go.
It's time to end this.
No, Vic, it's clobbering time. Bam! Damn. I've been waiting to do that. Love it. Let me do this one real quick. This is also another one of those I love. When Reed, and it almost made me cry. I'm not going to lie. Listen, it doesn't take a lot to make me cry these days. He goes to Ben, and he's just like, Ben, I swear to you, I will do everything in my power until there's not a breath left in me. You're going to be Ben again. And I was like, fuck.
The gays have a flair for the dramatic.
Just so perfect. So absolutely. 100%. And for this last one, do you want to be Ben or do you want to be Alicia?
Can I be Ben?
Go ahead. All right, here we go. You know, being different isn't always a bad thing.
Trust me, this ain't one of those times.
Not if you don't want it to be. But
that was such a great moment. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And it, you know what? It would have made it even better. What? If it was a blind actor.
Yes.
Well. I feel like we need a bingo card. Like, Sly makes a 911 reference. Sly yells about able-bodied actors playing disabled characters. Like,
Mario can't pronounce actors' names. It's been like 2 weeks in a row. I still can't say... Ivan Gorvich, Gorman, Gorman, the Mark Miller from the last week.
Goran Vishnik.
Goran Vishnik. Ivan Vigorvich. Okay.
I didn't even know what you were trying to say.
Sorry, coughing. Let's go ahead and move on to our next class, music room, where superhero movies of this era are remembered for their original soundtracks. Does the music in this movie hold up or have any songs that are still bangers today? And you know what? There's a few songs in here that I really like. Did you, I know that you said there was three, you couldn't remember the names, but we both agree, I think, my favorite song in the movie is when Johnny reveals himself and then it puts in basically On Fire by... I believe Kwame is the name of the writer, but it's Lloyd Banks, 50 Cent, Harry Potter, Eminem, and all these people. It's like it's a classic 2000 song. If you've heard it, you absolutely know what it is. And it's perfect moment. It's a perfectly laced track. Fits this actual moment, the character. It's all there, and I think it's a wonderful send off for this. But yeah, was there any other ones that you remembered or any scenes specifically? Like, yeah, it's a good track.
Like, there were a couple that just, like, at the time I was like, oh, wow, like, that music's a banger and fits the scene. But that moment with the reveal with On Fire playing was just, like, the, zenith of this, like, this category. How it's classic song, dope moment in the film, just, like, so reminiscent of that time.
Yes.
So great.
And I forgot it too, which is awesome, because when basically when it happened, I was like, oh yeah, that happened. I remember that now. And it was so cool to rediscover it for the second time. Obviously, some of the other tracks on the soundtrack are Sum 41, which are alumni on this category. They, of course, were on the Spider-Man soundtrack. And some other hits are on the actual OST, the original soundtrack. So definitely check it out. Looks like we do now have the music list for Apple is now available. Slide took care of that. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. And I feel like the world has forgotten about Spotify at this point. we'll make it the judgment call later. But obviously, we'll take that down the road. But yeah, that's been Music Room. Okay, to the best part of the show. Now we are moving into quiz time. There's only gonna be three questions. Actually, one, two.
Oh boy.
There's three questions, so it's a little bit shorter quiz, but I think this will get straight to the point. First question, of course, this is the easy point. Is Stanley in this movie?
Yes, he is, in fact, in this movie. He's the mail carrier dude that hands him the stack of all the fucking late notices on the bills.
That's right. Yes, that's right. He's in the movie. He actually has like a character name in here, which is I thought was interesting. So yeah, that's funny. But yeah, good old Stanley coming in. I mean, this is his first major creation, so he kind of had to be in this movie in a lot of ways. And so I think it was really wonderful for him to have an interaction with his characters. According to, I think
it's one of the longest times we've seen him on screen.
His longest is he's got dialogue. He interacts with characters. I said he has a character name. He's got like a SAG-AFTRA like paycheck waiting for him. He's still getting residuals on this movie. If he wasn't already a producer. So yeah. yeah, so cool. I'm trying to like not, I like remembering things. I'm like, I should not say that. Okay. That's for future stuff, future podcast.
Ooh.
One of the main cast members. Oh, that was okay. This actually goes with this question. One of the main cast members is a massive fan of the Fantastic Four comics before taking on the role. Which cast member is it? Was it A, Mr. Fantastic? Whatever.
Whatever his name is.
B, Jessica Alba. C, Chris Evans. And D, Michael Chiklis. All right, so we got Jessica Alba. I did not even
look at these questions beforehand.
They were written moments before we start recording. So
I feel like the wild card here is D. And so because of that, I'm going to go with it. I'm going to say Michael Chiklis.
Michael Chiklis is a massive fan of the Fantastic Four. He pushed.
Exudes nerd energy. That's all I'm gonna say.
He pushed, looks like a fucking nerd. He pushed for, which is hilarious if you know who he's, where he's from originally, but he pushed for them to not do CG. They wanted to do prosthetics. So he really was like, I want to put this fucking gear on and be this character, which for the most part, the prosthetics works for me. There's one moment where he like does this and it bends, and I'm like, how does Rock do that? And obviously, I think the face, I really think they could have done more with the face to make it more. I did love, there's the scene, obviously, where Chris Evans shows him the toy, and it's just a Marvel toy. Like, it's just, like, the original eye sets and stuff like that. I wish they just went with that face, personally, and maybe CGI'd the face. But I think the body looks decent for the most part when it's on screen. Better than the original Richard Corbin version, which... It's the version of the movie that we will not be doing unless we have a Patreon or we come up with an idea for it. That looks awful. I've been saying a lot. I gotta stop that. But I prefer this look than the CGI that we get later in the other film. So that's just my personal opinion. The other thing that I was going to say was Stanley, at the time of this movie, was his favorite performance of any of the characters that he's ever created. Was Michael Chiklis' version of the Thing. So that was cool. Nice. You guys,
I'm sure that's a great moment as a fan.
As a fan, where you're like, oh my God, I love this character and I play
Stanley likes my performance. Yes. That's incredible. Good that for him. Incredible.
And Michael Chiklis originally was actually famous for a TV show called The Shield, where he plays an awful human being. So that's why it's kind of funny. And now the third question. In a deleted scene, a cameo from another famous superhero movie is referenced. Who was it? So they're talking about specifically a character. I won't say what else because we... It was
referenced.
It's very much referenced. Now the answer here is it A, Professor X, B, Daredevil, C, Spider-Man, and D, Logan Wolverine.
Ooh, that's a tough one. I'm trying to think of, like, what characters were like popular at the time. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Spider-Man's always popular, but like, I feel like nobody knew Daredevil enough for that to be a reference.
I'm going to tell you the scenario, what the scene is, because we're going to watch it. The scenario, yes, the scenario is Mr. Fantastic is talking to Sue, and he does something with his face to make him look like this character.
Oh, I'm going to go Wolverine then. He has the like weird face shape.
It is, in fact, Wolverine has a deleted scene cameo in this movie, which kind of means that the Fantastic Four movie exists in the same universe as the X-Men movies, possibly. But it's a deleted scene, so I guess it's not really connected. But we're going to quickly watch this scene. So this is definitely going to be visual for your audio listeners. Please check out our lovely podcast over there at Point in Progress on YouTube. We do a lot of fun things, and you should be a part of it. It would be great if you were there to see all the fun things that we're about to do. So give me one second to set this up. I'm gonna make sure I have the video ready to go. And you know, stuff just happens. It always just happens.
Sometimes stuff just happens.
All right, so I'm gonna go switch this to here. By the way, how are you doing, lovely podcast? Are you having a good time? Are you enjoying me stalling?
Are you not going to cut this? Or are we just going to keep?
No, I'm going to keep going. We have to release this. You know, straight riffing. You guys like this stuff? Do you like? If you like it, please leave us a review. Actually, that'd be really helpful. Just so you know, Apple has reviews and Spotify also has reviews. I'm going to keep riffing until I figure this out. Got it. Okay, I wanted you to be able to hear it, so that's why. Or at least get the camera.
Gotcha.
For it. All right. All right, so we're going to switch to that transition. Oh, look, it's a Point in Progress logo popped up.
Yeah. Fancy.
Fancy. Here you go. I think it was me that asked you. Right. There's no caption.
You know, a girl can grow old waiting around for you to take charge.
Well, we can't all be as bold
as who? Victor? You know, there is no me in Victor. Never was.
Well, I guess that's what I thought you always wanted. A stronger man.
I did, really. But I wanted you to be that.
I love that.
That was, yeah. So that is, of course...
a stronger man.
So that's what that looks like. It looked rough, but it definitely was cool that they at least considered to putting somewhat of the Wolverine X-Men universe in there, which how would they know who that is? I assume he was on TV at some point. I don't know. But stronger man, of course, it looked like Wolverine. So very funny. But yeah, so you got a perfect score this week. It is 3 for 3. You nailed it. Fantastic. Well, I guess we're going to go ahead and do our final thoughts on the film. I mean, is there anything you want to say left on this movie? Anything you want to preface about it?
I guess I would just say I recommend this movie. I think you should experience it. Don't have high hopes going into it. Like, you know, just have a fun time with it, because it really was enjoyable. It was super funny. I like most of the jokes, except for the couple we mentioned, really landed for me, right?
Yeah.
Like, it was a fun time. And, you know, it's not too long. It's what, an hour 45? Like, it's fine. Enjoy it. Have fun with it.
Yeah.
It's a fine movie.
This is definitely one of those like movies that like is on TV on a Sunday and you're like, I'm not gonna change the channel. It's like it's totally worth that little experience.
There we go.
Yeah. If you have not seen it since being a child and you wanna see what it's if it holds up or not, I think it does. I just think that it's not in the same level, like it's no Batman, right? It's no like Christopher Nolan's Batman, Matt Reeves, like the Hulk, even in terms of like complexity. It's simply just, hey, four people got really hurt and they're trying to figure out if they could fix it. Turns out they can't. They're going to become superheroes. That's literally the plot. But ultimately, I think that the interactions of the characters, what really sells it, makes it a fun movie, makes it a very entertaining movie, and enjoy the time capsule of time. I mean, one of the people that we did not reference in this movie is Maria Menounos, who, if you know her, if you've been to an AMC theater, you would see her under Newbie, and you would see her like introduce like trailers and stuff like that. But yeah, she was a big fixture in there as like a hostess in the early times. So yeah, this was her big role. I liked her character. She's kind of kick ass. You know, took no shit. Not just like some random lady that he was. She doesn't come back later though. That sucked. That was weird. But yeah, otherwise, go check this movie out. Totally. All right. Well, guess what? We are gearing up for the third installment for the next X-Men movie that we'll be doing X-Men Last Stand, directed by Brett Ratner. Oh, I felt bad to say, he's a terrible human being. Fucking awful human being. Also semi inspired by Joss Whedon's script. Sorry, I'm gonna puke. I'm gonna puke a little. This, at the time of the release of these movies, this was the worst fucking X-Men movie at the time. I'm letting all that go, and I'm hoping that it's good. Sly, you've never seen it.
We're going into it with an open mind. That's right. I have no idea what I'm in store for.
You don't know who, what it's about. You don't know the characters. You don't know what's going on. That's totally fine. Will it be a return of me wearing Cyclops glasses? Yes. Yes, it will. I'll be wearing those next week.
Oh, yeah. I'm very excited. Bringing them back.
Hell yeah. I want to buy new ones. Now that I got a job, I'm going to buy real ones. I'm really excited. I made a casting thing on Twitter. Check that out. Check me out at Night Mute City. But yeah, enjoy. Get ready for us. X-Men Last Stand, that is currently on Disney Plus. So if you want to watch with us, it'll be in about 2 weeks. And it's going to be fun. So excited about that. Sly, where can people find you on the net?
You can find me personally anywhere on the internet at CycloneMC. If you're listening to this the week it releases, we are throwing a funeral for Stark Radio. Very sad. Our final episode this Saturday. Come check it out and hear about what we have in store for the future. Because while it's very sad, we have so many great things to come. Mm-hmm. So. Check that out Saturday, 8 p.m. Eastern.
Fantastic. Well, you can, of course, find me over here at Point in Progress, where we do our main podcast, which goes live on Friday. Release schedule, we're figuring out. A lot of changes have happened in our personal lives that we need to start leveling out. But episodes will go live, audio as well. And then for this show, like I said, it's about bi-weekly. So expect an episode every 2 weeks. And then for all the other little projects, I know Frank's working on something over there. It's going to be fantastic. Oh, that was weird. 1 second. Sorry, person. I don't know why I did that. We're good. So when it comes to everything else, you can follow me over at Twitter at that. That Marvera. Sorry. By the way, Echo Clo, if you watch the show, I don't think you do. Help me get my account back. Come on. Give me those Rooster Teeth connections. You can find me at Night Mute City, where a lot of my stuff is, including all the Tech Raptor work that we've been doing. And that's where you'll find me. So.
Oh, I forgot. I'm also doing a new thing that starts this week.
Oh, cool.
On Thursdays, JJ, former guest, and I are going to do live streams recapping 911 and 911 Lone Star.
That just fits.
Give yourselves a couple days to watch the new episodes. They, you know, show on Mondays and we're going to do the live on Thursday. So you got plenty of time to think about it, marinate, see how you feel about the episodes. And then we're going to do a live on Thursday nights, hopefully.
Very cool. So,
very exciting.
That 100% makes sense specifically for both of you because, you know, you guys love that show. But I think getting into media and media reactions, I think is definitely something. So that's smart. And with that, class is dismissed.
The cloud has fundamentally altered our DNA.
That's gross.
Reed, look at me.
I can't. He's heating up from his core.
You don't want to walk around on fire for the rest of your life, do you?
Is that a trick question?
Come on, am I the only guy who thinks this is cool? What if we got these powers for a reason?
I've always wanted power.
Victor, you always thought you were a god.
Let's not fight.
No, let's. Don't even think about it.
Never do.
Oh, you're hot.
Why, thank you. So are you.